I'll get started there. I guess before I start, I'll just ask if the lights is fine with that, or do you want more lights in the room, or?
I think we're good. That shows the screen really well.
Yeah, I guess it does show the screen pretty well there. Now, I always like to start off the lectures by doing a quote. This time I decided to quote myself on a few things that I've said on occasion there. And that's basically that ufology is more than just little green men and flying saucers and that. It's a study of claims, is really what it is, and about how you go about discerning fact from fiction. So we'll get into that in a little bit there, but I guess I'll just start with some of the introductions. Welcome and thank you for coming for the first course for the semester here. This is the second semester for the group now. We just started back in the fall. So we've got a little bit bigger now. If you've noticed the Rush Week table, it's pretty well designed and set up. But I'll start with myself. My name is Evan. I'm a third year computer science major currently. I'm doing a minor in physics as well. And I mean, I've just been absolutely fascinated by the topic of UFOs and aliens and that basically for my entire life. And now it's actually really interesting. You can actually get degrees and stuff. At particular universities, you can get degrees in ufology. That's not anything I have, so I don't have any formal training. But I guess I could consider myself to be like a resident expert on the subject matter, just because I've done so much research and like read every book I can on it and watched hundreds of different documentaries and various audio podcasts that go along with that. So that's just a little bit on myself. And then for the executives of the club, we have a vice president, and that's Shelby in the green sort of right there. And then we also have the treasurer for the group, Thomas, and he's not currently here right now, but those are the three executives we have for the club. And then I guess I'll give it out to the other three people here if you want to introduce yourself and maybe say like what interested you about this this club or what maybe you'd like to hope, maybe you'd like to learn.
I can go first. I'm Keelian. I am a second year poli-sci major. I noticed this club with your table at Rush Week today. And I really love aliens. I really love looking at the stars. I love just that sensation that you get of like how tiny we are and that there's probably other things out there doing the same thing infinitely far away. Last semester I took philosophy through science fiction and we talked a lot about the existence of aliens and what that means for us.
That sounds like a cool course.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun, so I want to, this semester, seriously lacking any aliens in my courses, so I think that joining this club might be a good place to pick that up.
Good call.
And back there?
My name's Kristen. I'm a second year public health major. I'm basically interested in all the conspiracies and alien conspiracies specifically out there. So that's the main reason
I joined this club. So many more.
I'm Kaylee. I'm first year accounting.
I don't know if aliens are just
cool. Yeah, I mean, that's pretty great there, actually. And yeah, in this club, as you mentioned, some different courses with the studies of philosophy, and we'll touch on some of those subject matter, and a lot of, when it comes to astronomy and the science behind it, we'll get into that as well. But it's a lot more scientific than most people would actually initially believe, and I guess that's because of the stigma around the whole subject matter, but we'll get into that as well. So I guess that's good for the introduction there. As well, if you notice on the side, I've got a video camera set up. That's for anybody at home, hey, if you're watching. Because a lot of people are like interested in the club, but apparently every club is meeting at this time on this night. And there was last semester, there was tons of classes at this time. So that also gives people an opportunity to still partake. They won't be here and be able to like ask questions or do any of the interactive stuff that we have that I've set up for the semester, but they can still partake in kind of the subject matter. Now, I'll just start with a few basic ground rules. This is a class, so I obviously expect that like, you're being respectful if you're here and not causing any major disruptions. That's okay, you can braid your hair.
I decided not to.
You decided not to braid your hair, okay. But at the same time, it's a fun class, and so you don't have to worry about any tests or midterms or finals or anything like that. There's no projects, you're not getting marked on it. But I guess you can really think of it as like an extension to the liberal education side of your degree. A big part of the GLRS here at the University of Lethbridge is to get you that that stuff outside of your major that gets you a more enriched enlightenment, and it doesn't necessarily pertain to anything in particular. But it's all about that liberal education values. And as well, a big part of that too, and a big part of the university, is it's not necessarily about learning any tools or skill sets. It's about learning how to learn and understanding principles of basic skepticism and things like that that play into a lot of scientific research and data. And like, I don't know if any of you remember the NSO, New Student Orientation presentation that was done in the gym. I always get the vice president of the school here to do it. For me, it was a couple of years ago, it was fall 2015. But one of the very first things that they talk about is questioning everything. Taking everything you fundamentally understand, or at least that you think you believe to be true, and it's about questioning whether or not there's different means to do things, whether or not there's a better way. And he challenged us too to question, like, is your professor really as knowledgeable as he claims? Is the stuff they read in the textbook actually true for that matter? And it's all about asking these different questions. It's the person standing in front of you who's got like bright pink shoes on, an Area 51 hat, and a really nice hoodie, by the way. I'll start up in that. Does he actually really know anything about what he's talking about? So it's this idea of asking different questions, and it's about a perspective change. Being able to take what you currently view and just look at it from a different angle, through a different lens, and see if you come to the same conclusions that you already do about basic facts of life. Now, this first lecture here, I combined it with last semester. I did two separate ones. There was an introduction course, and then there was an entire course dedicated on how to be a good skeptic. And I mostly combined them for this course because maybe other people would have already taken it in the first semester, and it gives more opportunity to add in extra new content, an extra course in there. So I've basically taken the best parts of the two initial courses that were done in the fall and put them together. So it's a bit of a review for anybody that has been here before or watched it online before. But at the same time, I've also put a bit new content in, different videos and stuff we're going to look at. And the format of the class essentially follows. It's a 2-hour lecture, roughly. This one might go a little longer just because of the amount of stuff that I have planned for it. But essentially, it's about, roughly speaking, 1 hour of videos on YouTube, and we'll look at various different videos and documentary series, and then another hour of me explaining different concepts and even the science principles that go behind various things. So it usually goes from 7 till 9, and it will be in this room every week at 7 p.m. Now, I guess I'll start now with, what exactly is ufology? Well, as defined by me, and I put it that way because there's many other different ufologists around the world, and they may have their own perspectives and their own opinions on it, but the way I define it is it's a study of claims, and all these claims that have been made about like alien abduction or UFO sightings, and the whole principle behind it is being able to look at how do you go about discerning the fact from the fiction. And another big part, a misdemeanor, I guess you could put it that way, that people always get caught up in is like, oh, well, maybe it's the government, or maybe it's swamp gas, or all these other things. But in the essence, it's still very important to understand that it doesn't matter the who. You're asking the wrong question if you're asking who, because it doesn't matter if it's aliens or the government or scientific principles that can be explained. It's all about the how and the when and the where, because if you say, for example, just disregard aliens and UFOs entirely, then you still have a really interesting area of research into human psychology and what would compel masses of people to all claim that they saw something if it wasn't actually there, and how does that psychologically impact the person over the course of their life. So it's a lot of different studies. You can go into psychology and that, which I think is the second point there. Yeah, it incorporates many different fields. It's not just one thing. It's not just just science or physics or astronomy, but there's also the journalism aspects to it, and people that work on movies. And if you've noticed, actually, like, especially in recent years, there's a huge amount of effort that goes into making alien movies as scientifically accurate as possible. There's a man by the name of Nick Pope. He worked as the British Ministry of Defense for several years, and he's essentially the number one contact for any big Hollywood producer to actually verify facts on different alien and UFO stuff. And so he actually kind of makes like a career out of this, being able to verify facts and look into that. So it incorporates many different fields. And the other thing to note is that it does not require anything more than passion, really. And what do I mean by this is, if you say you're a musician, I'm sure you have a passion for the music you play, but unless you can also play an instrument, you're not a musician. Or you say that you're a doctor because you watch videos of open heart surgery on YouTube. Well, I'd rather keep the tumors I might have in that case. So you don't need any particular skill, you just kind of need a passion to be able to go out and explore different aspects and combine areas of astronomy together. And as I mentioned, with the fact that it incorporates many different fields, you can really do all kinds of different work in writing or movies or actually the scientific study and analysis of it. And the final fact that needs to be noted is it's not a recognized or self-identified science. It's not intentionally a science because of one major thing that it lacks, that any good science study needs, and that is a falsifiability principle. Now, I'll get into this when I go into the skepticism lecture, but the whole idea is that you need to be able to have an idea, a claim, a hypothesis, and it has to be able to be false. That's why religion and science don't usually get together, get along too well, is because you can't necessarily disprove God and you also can't prove him. And so that's why religion is all based on faith. But when it comes to this, the whole reason behind UFOs not being a science is because you can't really identify or falsify a claim. Somebody says they were abducted. There's no really way to go about proving that they were not abducted. However, I put yet in there. And the reason I believe that it could in the future potentially be an actual recognized science is because of a brand new area of computer science that I came across just a couple of years ago. I mentioned I was a computer science major, and I'll just talk about artificial intelligence for one quick sec here. Essentially speaking, there's two key notes that need to be noted down. You have adaptive AI, and you have predictive AI. Now, with adaptive AI, that's like when you build a software that wants to compete with the world's greatest chess player, and it kind of like watches their moves and learns different strategies of how to play the game of chess, and it can eventually get to the point that it will be better than the professional players. And another thing with adaptive AI is like the ads you see online. You go on eBay and you're looking for one thing, and then everywhere you go, on YouTube, on Facebook, on Google, you just get ads swarmed to you with this one thing that you were just looking for one day on eBay. So that's adaptive AI. Predictive AI is a bit different, and it's a brand new area that was developed in computer science within the last couple of recent years, and it's about taking the data that you have, and it could be this massive amount of data. You couldn't even graph it on like a 2D graph or a 3D graph. You'd have to do all this multi-dimensional matrices and all that to do the calculation, and it's way too complicated for a person to be able to extrapolate meaningful data from that, but a computer program can do just that. And to demonstrate, I'll just show you this one software that I came across called Predpol. Alright. So essentially with this predictive AI software, they were actually able to reduce over a period of years the crime in the city by 60%. Now it's like a huge statistical thing by being able to be there where the crimes were predicted. Now, when I first seen this, I was like absolutely blown away because I realized that you could apply it, the same principles and idea, to UFOs. Because it doesn't matter whether it is the government, or it doesn't matter whether it is aliens, or it is some natural phenomena that's causing this to happen. The thing is, all of them would have to follow some logical pattern behind it, and especially when it comes to like the government, or if it's an alien intelligence that's behind it. If you can actually take all of the data of different UFO cases and take the most credible ones and be able to extrapolate that into the future, and if you could predict where and when a future UFO sighting would occur, you could not only show that it has a basis in scientific fact, but that it's also under intelligent control because it follows a pattern that the computer would actually be able to recognize. So that's just a little bit on that. Another way that you could potentially, that may potentially bring this field more into the public eye, is with an organization known as MUFON. It stands for the Mutual UFO Network, and essentially they have about 3,000 members worldwide and about 400 field agents. And now these field agents actually go out to like people's houses and people's workplaces and that to interview them and gather evidence in that. If that person believes that they had seen a UFO or they had some type of encounter, they can actually go on their website and file a report with them, and they treat it like an actual forensic analysis investigation. So they'll do different, they'll do like police sketching, and they'll also look for maybe there's trace evidence that the UFO left behind, and they'll obviously collect any pictures and videos and stuff if they have that to go along with it. But it's actually really scientific oriented because they do this field training, and the manual is actually, it's like a 256 page manual that they actually have to go through, and they offer courses online through their own, it's the MUFON University, and you can actually go with them and become a field agent, and they've got places all around. Now I haven't looked into it yet, but I might be trying to, because I wanted to do a, get some public speaker or whatever for this semester to come. For maybe a night, and we'll do a weekend thing. But a lot of them too are really expensive, but I figure maybe there's, well, I know there's a director of MUFON in Calgary that kind of runs a club, or not a club, but the group of MUFON in Calgary, so maybe I can contact them and get them to come down. I'll just see about that in the future. But I'll show you their website here, because this is one of the benefits that you get along with being in the club here, is they have a ton of different features on their website. They have this live UFO map, which is really cool. You get this like visual thing, and it's got the different shapes and different styles of UFOs, and you can click on them to find out more information on that. The other thing, well, I mentioned the database. If you log in with them and in the account that we have set up there, I put the password and username on the board there. I also sent it out an email. Essentially, it's the U of L UFOlogy group, and the password is Stranger Things, but the I in things is actually a one. So if you actually log in here, what you get when you log in is you get access to their database, and this is where you can actually go and see all of the different cases that people have filed in all of the countries all around the world. This is a global organization, and even here in Lethbridge, I can actually go there and type in the city of Lethbridge, and you'll see that there's, I think it's six or seven actual UFO reportings that have been filed with people here in the city at some point over the years when they were doing this. It does take a bit of time. Database. But yeah, you see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Is that one new?
Ah, yeah. 12/11. That was just this last month, the December 11th. And then, so you can also attach pictures and stuff with it. So somebody, little picture's upside down. But I guess apparently somebody took that picture and they attached it. That's the other thing too, is you'll notice there's no snow on the ground here. You can file the reports at any time, even if it's like been years and years since a UFO sighting and you still have the evidence and stuff, you can file it. So I would guess that this is probably not recent because there's no snow on the ground, but it shows up as being filed December 11th, just as the last month here in Lethbridge. And you can add a description and various pictures with that. So that's just a little side of the database, and you can have fun exploring that. And the other thing that's really neat too is they have an e-journal that they publish every month, and you can go in there and you can go all the way back to, I think it's January 2013, and look at all of their different journals, and it's just absolutely packed full of the scientific researchers and their stories and the field agents that go out into there. And if you want to, I have a printed out copy here with the group. I always like to print it out in case anybody would rather read the paper material. As well, I took a ton of different books here that we actually have, and there's a list of them that I sent out in the email with the registration. So you can see that, and you can come up here and have a look at the books too. And if anything interests you, and please do, like, have a look at them. If anything interests you, you can sign them out with the club and take them and read through them on your own there. But they also like to use various aspects of the books and that incorporated into the lectures that I do over the course of the semester. So that is one of the two member benefits we get. I'll get into Coast to Coast later. But that's a bit on MUFON and the work that they do. And this is their actual field kit right there. They actually get like this forensic analysis kit when you're the field agent, and then you can go out and collect evidence and stuff. That's the director, the current director of MUFON, J.C. Harzan, and this is a little bit of their story. So that's a little bit there on MUFON. Now, talking about these people that are ufologists, I just thought I'd put a few different notable people in here. This is J. Allen Hynek, and he's essentially the founder of modern day ufology as it pertains to things like MUFON. And essentially, he was part of a committee back in the 50s that was set out initially by the government, or the Air Force, and it was eventually taken over by the University of Colorado to do scientific research on it. And there is a whole story behind why it was actually really biased from the start and why it was not a good report. But essentially, he was one of the members on this committee that was known as the Condon Committee. And he didn't like what was going on because the person that was in charge, Edward Condon, essentially had the bias right from the start. Before even doing any of the research, he was just flat out, no, this is crap, and we're just gonna publish this paper saying that it's crap, and that's exactly what they did. So J. Allen Hynek actually went on to found a few different organizations of his own that was more focused on taking the bias out, and we're gonna look at the facts before we go making opinions and judgments and that. He's also the man responsible for creating what's known as the Hynek scale, and that is from 1 to 7, and it's in terms of severity of UFO sightings. So you hear about close encounters, or the fourth kind, third kind, things like that. That's actually a skill that he devised. This is Leslie Keene, and she's an investigative journalist and author, written tons of different subject matter on the area of UFOs. She's been featured in countless different documentaries, and she's also actually taken activism in trying to lobby government for different information and disclosure. And she even sued NASA once, too, but she believed that they had reason to believe that NASA was withholding information from a UFO case that took place in Pennsylvania in 1965, and she actually sued them, and then she also wrote a book there. This is Dr. Stephen Greer. Now, I always love this name, too, because in the area of UFOs, there's also a few other people. There's a John Lear, and there's also a Dr. Roger Greer. So it's kind of confusing to remember the different names, because they're so similar. But he's actually an American physicist, and initially a physicist turned into ufologist. And he founded CSETI in 1990, which stands for the Center for the Search for Extraterrestrial Life. It's kind of the extension to the SETI project that was created back in the 60s. And in 1993, he also founded the Disclosure Project. And just recently, in 2013, he was part of producing a documentary called Sirius that was all about UFOs and disclosure. And then this is probably my favorite. Absolute favorite guy on the list here. This is Art Bell, and he's a radio personality who essentially he single-handedly revolutionized the genre of overnight talk radio by turning his radio station that he was given a chance to kind of do whatever, be liberal with, and he turned it into this talk forum for people to come and talk about anything and everything. And so they talk about ghost stories, and they talk about aliens, and they talk about witchcraft, and they talk about religion and demons and all these other things that they just kind of combine into this radio podcast. And it's so fascinating to listen to, and I'll just like be doing homework and have this playing in the background. But he did this during the 70s and 80s, and he created this radio station called Coast to Coast AM. It's still in operation today with over 1,000 different radio stations that play on their channel, and they have over 1 million listeners worldwide every night. And the crazy thing is, this is like something most people have never heard of, this radio station, this talk show, Coast to Coast AM, and yet it's the largest worldwide radio broadcast, radio podcast, and so many people don't know about it, but we have a membership with them, which is really cool. So you can go and you can log in for their Coast to Coast AM sign up, and you can go through their archives, and it's the same password and username, and you can look at their past podcasts, and you can listen to them live too. And they go from 11 o'clock to 2 in the morning every day, because it's a late night talk show, so that's kind of their whole genre and theme behind it. But we got a membership with them, and that was all started by Art Bell. Currently it's hosted by George Noy, which is his successor in broadcast. Now, as a pop quiz, I don't think so, but are any of you in any of the astronomy courses this semester? Okay, there's two astronomy courses being held this semester, and I'm in both of them. We are in the cosmology, and the other one is the solar system. And this was actually briefly mentioned the other day in class. Does anybody happen to know what this picture is? Shelby knows. Well, essentially, this is the Hubble Deep Field image, and it was kind of like mentioned briefly in class, and we didn't really go into anything with it. I think that we will probably later in the future there, but what happened, and this is actually really interesting, is a lot of people don't realize that Hubble never had the reputation that it does today. In fact, when they first launched the Hubble Space Telescope, it was basically the laughingstock of the scientific community because of what a disgrace. What happened, there's a defect on the mirror. It caused blurry pictures for 3 years after the launch of the Hubble Space Satellite. And so when they finally got the mirrors fixed, they needed this big project to kind of regain their reputation. And I'll kind of explain a little bit here of how it works. So if you've got your night sky that you're looking at here, space there, and you've got all of these points of light, all of these dots, and some of them are nearby stars, many of them are faraway stars, lots of them are actually entire other galaxies. And so if you're an astronomer who wants to study this stuff, you take your telescopes and you point them here, and here, and here, and anywhere you see a point of light, that's where you're going to get your best data. But what happened with the Hubble Deep Field image, a bunch of really smart, clever scientists got together, and they said, what would happen if we pointed our telescope here? where it's completely black and there's absolutely nothing. And they're like, oh, well, let's find out. And so they did. They spent 10 days doing this. And I mean, it's pretty funny, actually. I mean, you think you're not going to find anything. And what are you, crazy? There's nothing there. You want funding, too? Oh, my God. So they did this, and the satellite orbited Earth for a period of 10 days, focusing on one region of space, and eventually, as light comes in, as the focus is extended to a greater time period, then the image starts to become more and more clear. And this is essentially the image that they got. Now, the significance behind this image is that this is the number of galaxies, every single one of these is a galaxy, none of those stars, in absolutely nothing. This is a completely black region of space, there's nothing there, you can't see it with nearby telescopes or with the visually just looking up in the sky, and yet when you look at it, you just see it's everywhere. There's galaxies that just go on and on forever. And so when scientists found this picture, they were absolutely shocked. They went, holy crap, the universe is way, way bigger than we ever even imagined possible. And it took the statistics that they had before on estimating the probability of alien life, and it just put them way, way high up there. And that was basically because of a man named Frank Drake. Now, this is the Drake equation, and essentially it goes like this. N equals R star times, FP. N equals R star times FP times NE times FL times FI times FC. And then times L. And all of these have significance in what they mean. And essentially, it starts with the very most important thing, R star, is the rate of star growth. And this is on a yearly basis. So this is how many stars are being born every single year in our own galaxy. And this statistical number only applies to one galaxy. So you can apply it to ours or any others. But it doesn't look at the universe as a whole because it just really can't do that mathematically. But essentially, it's the rate of star growth. And then FP is the fraction of stars that have planets. So do you think that every single star that exists out there is a planet? Or is it kind of like a 50-50 basis? That's the number you put in there. NE is the number, average number of planets that you could have around the star. So do you have lots like us, you've got 8 planets orbiting the star? Or is it more like 2 or 3 if you do? Or is it just 0? So FL stands for the fraction. It's a percentage that could develop life. Is it sustainable for life? And it's important to keep in mind, too, that this doesn't necessarily mean that it needs water, because that only limits it to life as we know it. It completely self-removes any other form of life that could develop, and things like silicon are a great substitute for like DNA strands, and who knows that a life form couldn't have developed using that. FI is the fraction of planets that developed intelligence. Is it just like an animal species on the planet, or is it actually intelligent? And then on top of that is FC, and that's the fraction that developed communication, because you can have intelligent thinking beings that can't really communicate. And this is a really important factor too, because this is interstellar communication. So for the last one, which is L, this is the lifespan that a civilization can remain in communication with the universe. So it's not like the 13,000 years or whatever that humanity has been around on the planet. It's only the last 50 years that we've been able to communicate and send out radio waves and stuff like that into interstellar space. So that's actually a really low number for us. But I'll give you a demonstration here, and you can put in the numbers yourself to see exactly what comes up. So we've got the rate of star formation, and we've got different options, 1 billion, 10 billion, 100 billion, and this is essentially saying how many stars can exist in the galaxy at any one time. So if anyone wants to give me a random number,
600,
right, 600 billion stars in the galaxy, and then if somebody wants to say percentage of those stars that have planets, is it 100%, is it more of a 50-50 basis? 40%, and then average number of planets, I don't know if you want to see it in the back.
Four.
Okay, we'll go with four planets there, And then FI is the percentage of those planets where life could develop.
1%.
Okay, 1%, pretty conservative numbers there. And then I'll put in some pretty low numbers here. Say percentage of planets where intelligence, I'll do 2% on that. Percentage of planets where technology develops, we'll do 0.5% on that. And then, does somebody want to give me an estimate lifetime that they can exist within communication? So for us, it would only be this one here, 100 years. But has another civilization had interstellar communication for a million years, 10,000 years?
10.
10 years or 10,000?
10 years.
Okay, 10 years. So then we'll do a calculate here. And then the number that you get down here on the bottom is the final number there. And it is, what's it got, 0.00096. So the thing with this is because it's on a yearly basis, and you estimated that it was there's only 10 years that a civilization could remain in interstellar communication. You take this number and you multiply it by 10. So the decimal moves over here, and this is the number of planets that you can have with interstellar communication. And this is actually a really low number. It's way less than one. And the thing that is a problem with this equation is all of these numbers don't really matter. NASA actually has a pretty good understanding of the first three here. They understand fairly well the rate of star formation, the fraction that have planets, and the number of planets average. It's the other ones that you can kind of speculate a bit more. But remember that these are a probability, a percentage. So at maximum, they only go to 1, which means if you set it to 1, you can just cancel all of these out, which means the most important factor is actually L. And if you do a low number L like you did there, you're going to get a low number like here. But if you say it's 1,000 years, you're going to get a much higher number. And then, so this one, you take the number that you get, which is 0.096, and then you would multiply that by 1,000. So you would move the decimal places 3 over. And then what you get for a final answer is 96 planets or civilizations that can exist in the Milky Way galaxy at any one time. So there is a problem with this equation, this calculation, is that the L is the most important factor that it resides upon. And when people do the estimations and calculations like you've seen there, you can have really, really low numbers or really astronomically high numbers. But it gives an idea, a sense of the things. It's less about the number that's important and more about the things that a civilization would actually need to be able to exist. And that's talking about the percentages. So that led directly into SETI. SETI was founded during the 60s by Frank Drake, and it was basically this idea that he had of let's actually go and do the work that requires to look into the night sky and collect radio waves and stuff like that. And SETI, the project is currently run by Seth Shostak, he's the director of SETI, and they actually operate using the Large Allen Telescope Array. I don't know if any of you have heard of that before. The Large Allen Telescope Array is a really big array in California. And how that works is interesting. With the telescope arrays, you get a big field, and you have all of these telescope dishes that you spread across, and they can all collect radio waves. And what this does is it actually creates a virtual disk that has the radius of the entire thing here. So instead of spending tons of money to build a disk this big, you can build a lot of really smaller ones and still get the same virtual surface area in terms of data collection. So they operate the Allen Telescope Array. And the reason it's called that, actually, is because it was mostly sponsored and funded by Paul Allen, who's the co-founder of Microsoft. So he's got his name attached to that, too. And so Frank Drake founded SETI, and Carl Sagan was a big proponent of it, as well doing things with his Cosmos series. So that's the first part of the lecture there, all this to cover the idea of ufology and what it really means, and some of the, giving you an idea and a little introduction into some of the work and research that actually goes into it. But another big thing that needs to be understood really well is actually what does skepticism mean and how to go about being a good skeptic. And it's often the case that people just assume that skeptical means that you're just going to deny everything that you see, but it's actually far more to it than just that. And the best skeptic there you see is Scully. But they can actually do really amazing things and play with that. I remember watching an X-Files episode where there was something that she believed absolutely, and Mulder was actually absolutely, there's no way he was going to believe in it. So being skeptical doesn't mean that you're just going to deny everything that comes to you. And obviously bias plays a big part of things too. You can't erase that because everybody has their own biases. But when it comes to a course like this, it's really important to understand skepticism. And I really think that every science course should actually do a unit or a lecture or something on how to be a good skeptic. So there's that too. Now, I talked about this idea before, about falsifiability and what does it mean. And essentially, the core concept is that you have to create a scientific hypothesis. Now, that was a big argument over scientific theories and stuff like that. When it comes to science, a theory is the absolute highest level of knowledge that can be attained. You can't really argue with the theory. But in general, everyday life, a theory, people kind of just use that word as, oh, it's something they think, but they don't really have any proof for. In science, it's completely different. The equivalent of a theory in science is a hypothesis. So you have to be able to say something, and it has to be able to be false. So when somebody comes to you and they say that they were abducted by aliens, you need to understand before you go into it that there's no way to falsify the claims that they have made. But you could possibly turn, as I said before, you turn the field of ufology into a science by being able to predict where future UFOs occur, because then it can be false. Maybe it doesn't actually happen, and then you can look at whether your data is wrong or whether there's actually nothing to be seen in the first place. And if it does, then you have something really significant. Now, oh yes. We'll do this video here. This is about rethinking doubt and how doubt is the engine that drives skepticism, that drives science. And so, yeah, it's important to know that doubt-driven skepticism is the engine that drives science forward. And it's, as he said, it's a tool. It's not necessarily a process or anything like that, but it's a tool that you can utilize in order to discern fact from fiction. Now, it does come with a few caveats with that. The first one is that ideas should not be rejected given substantial evidence based on your own personal desires to continue to reject them, as he says there with the denialist. All this evidence comes in, and you just really want to believe that it's all false, so then you just become a denialist of it. Evidence should not be based on past incursions, and what I essentially mean by this is if you get sent all of these pictures that are supposedly of UFOs, each and every single one of them needs to be looked at and analyzed without any previous bias based on the other pictures. Now, of course, if you get sent all these pictures by the same guy, and this one's fake, and that one's fake, and they continue to be fake, then you get into the case of the boy who cried wolf too many times. But when you're looking at the evidence, you don't want to just say, oh, this case I looked at last week was totally fake, so this one here must also be fake. You need to assess each one individually. And that good evidence will come in a manner that cannot be easily disputed, and it will be so absolutely insane that it would not be possible for it to have been fake. And I'll be talking in a little bit about what really makes good evidence for UFOs, and then versus some of the bad evidence for UFOs. Now, the burden of proof is another concept that needs to be covered, and essentially the burden of proof says that if you want to go and prove something, then it's your job to do so. You don't put that on other people. You don't throw it out to them and say, oh, I believe in Bigfoot. You go and find the evidence and the proof for it. You know, you actually have to go and find the proof for yourself. So in the field of ufology, the burden of proof lies on the ufologist to analyze the data and go and look for it, because there's no reason to just assume otherwise that there's anything of substantial value to it. Now, another big thing to understand about the burden of proof is that it's really, really hard to actually prove something. And I'm talking in all aspects. It doesn't really matter what it is that you're trying to prove. It's really difficult. Now, I took a Math 2000 course in my second year, and it was absolutely the worst course that I've ever taken. And for computer scientists, we all have to take this one course. And I have many friends that took it 3 or 4 times and kept failing it because, well, for one, the course kept changing in the curriculum, and that, and you learn something different each time. But the idea behind the course, in essence, is it's a mathematical proof foundational theorem. So this is an example of how hard it is to prove the pi is irrational. And what that means by pi is irrational just goes on forever and ever, it doesn't ever stop. And this is something you learn when you're like in grade 3 or really, really young, and you just accept that pi is irrational and that it doesn't have a finite number of digits, it goes on forever. But the proof for it is all this stuff. It's crazy. It's a page long, and half of it looks like gibberish. It's absolutely insane. When you take these fundamental ideas that you've held your entire life, such as pi is irrational, and these things that you were taught when you were really young, and then you have to break it down and go step by step in order to prove it. And that's why I hated Math 2000, and then what so many other people hated, is because it takes the things that you have essentially assumed your entire life, and it's like, why can't we just accept it? Well, because you need to prove it, and in order to prove it, you need to do lots of work. This is when it comes to mathematical proof. Well, how about this, for example? The Russia scandal with Trump. There's mountains and mountains of evidence and all of these things, and emails leaked, and actual conversations and video recordings and everything. Mountains of evidence, and yet there's no actual proof that there was any scandal with Russia. And so you get into the situation with this, and in the case of ufology, where you have this mountain of evidence that leads to something, but because it's so hard to actually prove something, it just kind of sits there. And it acts as really, really good supportive evidence, but as you can obviously tell, Trump is not in jail yet because of the scandal, because they can't prove it. Another thing is causation versus correlation. I took a statistics class in my first year, and we talked about this idea that you can have things that look perfectly straight on the graph. You plot them out, and you say there's absolutely a connection here. There has to be, because it forms a straight line. But when you get into the deeper essence of things, you can take any two things, and you can put them in a way that the math will form a straight line. And then you can use that to make your own biased influences. Here's an example here. This is organic food sales versus autism, and they're pretty closely correlated and aligned there. But that doesn't necessarily mean that organic food sales, or organic food in general, actually has anything to do with autism. Here's a picture, global average temperature versus the number of pirates over time. And this is dropping off as the year goes on, the number of pirates there. So you can actually say, based on this graph, you can make a claim that global warming is actually really good, because global warming caused pirates to decrease over time, and so it's actually a really good thing. But as you know, that's obviously absolute crazy talk. And then this is US spending on science, space, and technology, and suicides by hanging. And it's extremely close. So from this, you can obviously conclude that spending on space technology development is leading more people to suicide. But again, you have this case of things that you plot out, and the data looks really good, but you need to use a bit of judgment in your decision making as well that goes with that. And when it comes to the mountain of evidence on UFOs, it's really no different. And that's the unfortunate side of things, is that you can have all of this evidence that supports it, and yet there's still no definitive proof. But what we do have, though, is we have this. This is the number of MUFON sightings that have been reported each year, and I think the data goes up to 2011 there. So when it first started out, and back in 2000, there was that per year 1,000, and now it's up to like 7,000, and it's probably even more this year. And so it increases over time, which shows that there's more people getting involved. It shows that more people are accepting that it's an actual thing. And what it does is it normalizes something that would otherwise be completely crazy. And the more people that come forward and confront it and admit to whatever they saw, the more people will snowball onto that, and it'll just have this impact that keeps going and going. Because the fact is that as you increase in the number of people that are willing to admit something, then that increases in the number of people that otherwise wouldn't, unless there was significant data behind it. Here is also a graph from the percentage of people that do believe that alien life exists. This is not necessarily that it's come here and visited us in the past, but that somewhere out in the universe, and right now, this is from 2007, and I think it's even higher this year, but it's right up almost at the 100%. And a big part of that comes, too, with the Hubble Deep Field image, and scientists just realizing that statistically speaking, if you go far enough in the universe, you won't just find other life. You'll find an identical copy to yourself. Now, the actual size of the universe, you would have to travel far enough to find an identical copy, twin of yourself. I'm not talking parallel universes, I'm talking actual distance within our own universe, is just astronomically huge. It's absolutely crazy. Because really all we are is a collection of molecules and atoms together. And so when you're looking for patterns, you can look for patterns in piles of rocks and look around, and you find the same pattern. And eventually you look far enough into space, you'll find the exact same pattern of atoms that makes a copy of you. This also doesn't exclude. I mentioned I was in a cosmology course this semester, and my one professor really likes this saying, is that science or physics does not disallow it. And he's really able, he basically believes that anything is possible as long as science does not disallow it. And in fact, the science supports it based on the actual size of the universe. And it's a big deal too. When you're talking about different things with the denialists there, the big part of when it comes to climate change and the talks about that, the argument is not whether or not the climate is changing, because it is, and you cannot deny that. You just look around, and in September there was like 5 hurricanes. It's absolutely insane, all in 1 month there. And then most of December, California was just burning up. So climate change is happening. The argument comes in the idea that humans are responsible for it, because now you're putting onus on people that they actually have to take responsibility and not be burning all these fossil fuels. The same thing with the UFO cases. People don't deny that there is a life out there somewhere. The argument comes as to whether or not it's actually visited us in the past or currently, or whether or not there's any secret organizations that deal with this stuff. That's where the argument lies. And here's just a little bit on the actual proof of UFOs and at least a bit of statistical analysis. So that man is Stanton Freeman. He's one of the few Canadian ufologists, actually, and he's a big part of why Roswell was actually so famous. And I'll be covering that when I do my Roswell lecture. But for at least 30 years following the incident, it was just nothing to nobody until Stanton Freeman took the case and actually looked at some of the data that had been collected and stuff pertaining to Roswell. So that's a bit of interesting stuff there. And also, 95%, statistically speaking, 95% of UFO reports and cases have been and can be explained, but it's not 100. The other 5% are still mysteries, and that's what I try to focus on the most, obviously because you have the most credible data, and those are the close encounters. Now, there might be a few reasons that you would want to fake a paranormal experience, and the first one is for financial gain. not a video with the skeptic guy. It was a bit longer too. He also goes into reasons for faking anything, and he covers money, financial issues like 3 or 4 times there too. It's a big part, and that's why a lot of people, they feel that like if you're being paid to say something or whatnot, that you're far less credible. So a lot of people that will want to come forward maybe won't want to take any pay or whatever because they want to be more credible. And then for other people, maybe it's a compensation thing for them. Because you believe or you desire the proof that isn't there, and so you go and you make it yourself because you don't want to be mocked, you don't want to be part of this idea, this community that has such a stigma attached to it, and so you may want to just go out and make your own proof. Another one that was really interesting too, you might take it as a challenge. There might be those people that, you know, I really want to just nest. I want to see how far can I actually push something? How elaborate of a hoax can I make? And yet it would still be believable. And those are those people that do take that as a challenge. So that's a reason that a person might fake something. And you've also got any other ulterior motives that they might have. Now, when it comes to looking at like the evidence that you do have, that's really, really good evidence, the best cases have at least one of the following in the terms of there. They have multiple eyewitnesses. And now, when you're talking about different eyewitnesses, you can have several. It could just be you, or it could be a bunch of friends and family and that. But the best case for any UFO sighting actually took place in 1997 in Phoenix, Arizona, because it was seen by over 1,000 people, several thousand people in the city all at once. And what happened the following day when they did the press conference with the mayor of Phoenix, he basically mocked everyone and made a big joke about it, and it angered a lot of people in that because they felt that their actual genuine horror at what they had been seeing had just been coughed off as a laughable thing. And then he did actually years later admit that he too saw the exact same thing. And so you're dealing with thousands and thousands of people that add more credibility to it, especially if they all say the same thing, because you can have a ton of people that would want to collaborate together to maybe do a hoax, but you can't get 1,000 people on the exact same page, and yet if they do, there absolutely has to be something of value behind what is happening. Physical damage is caused to the human body. Now, this is a kind of strange one, because people have done a far lot worse to their body for far lot less. And you may actually have somebody who's absolutely insane and may actually scar themselves on purpose to claim that it was done during some alien abduction and scalpels and tools and things like that. You could have crazy people that do that. But at the same time, if a person's got all these burn marks or scar marks and things like that, it does lend a bit more credibility to their case because there's physical evidence on their body that actually exists. It's like, how else could they have been scarred or burned or whatnot? The event is not an isolated incident, and this is all about if it occurs over multiple days or it occurs over multiple states. Maybe the UFO is traveling over a trajectory and all of a sudden, like 10 p.m. at night, this one town is lit up, everybody is seeing this thing, and then another town just an hour later, just south of there, is lit up and then it follows this path. You can actually track the path of the UFO. So that's a non-isolated incident, but also you get something called UFO waves, and they're basically this like all at once, for no reason at all. You just get all of these sightings that happen in one little area, and it's over multiple days or even months sometimes, and that is definitely statistically important. Because as I mentioned before, it doesn't really matter like who's responsible, if it's the government or aliens, but maybe it's a natural phenomenon that's causing this over several months, and then you might want to explore that further to look at maybe it's some type of meteorological thing that you don't yet understand. Threats. This is a big one too. If a person is actually being confronted and threatened, and it can come in various different forms. I have a lecture set up. It's a bird, it's a plane. It deals everything with pilots. And I'm actually a pilot myself. I spent 6 years in the Air Cadets and did my pilot training with them. I don't have tons of flight hours and stuff like that that you'd expect a pilot to have. But those that do understand what is capable of flight and what isn't. And they've actually like witnessed and seen some things in the sky. And if it happens to be a UFO that they see, their job is on the line. They could actually lose that. And so you get all those credible people that have their threat of losing their job, or maybe it's the case of somebody actually coming to their home, you call it the Men in Black or whatever, that actually physically threatens them or holds a gun up to them or says, oh, there's a nice family you've got, what a shame it would happen if something happened to them. Because there's no reason that these threats would be made unless there was something specifically of value and interest there. Because you, if you're some organization that wants to keep secrets, you're not going to threat than random civilians just to make a public show of it. Now, photo and video evidence does exist, but it's not very good, and that's for many different reasons, is quality of camera and the fact that you can enhance things with Photoshop and all that. But the one thing that does exist, and very few does exist, is trace evidence. And that would be any kind of like metal, maybe there was a UFO crash and there was an actual explosion and you can look at the ground and you find traces of radiation that are way higher than any of the background radiation nearby, or broken trees. If a UFO is flying really low and goes over a treescape, you get this nice broken path along the trees. All this physical evidence, this is what MUFON focuses on mostly, because they're a forensic analysis team that actually will go out and collect the evidence. And they do spectroscopy scans of it and things to see, like, is this actually a metal and where did it come from? And when it comes to something like the Roswell incident, they had trace metal. Actually, this is really good right here. This is the fake photo shoot that apparently was done. This is MUFON Journal for January, so how fitting. For that, but apparently the real stuff of this is like tinfoil, the way they described it, but you could crumple it up into a ball and then lay it on the table and it would fold back out into a completely flat sheet and there would be no wrinkles, no evidence that it was ever crumpled into a ball, and apparently that's some of the trace evidence that was actually collected by the government and people like Philip J. Corso with the Roswell incident. So that's some good evidence there. And the other one is information that could not have been gained any other possible way. And I guess the best case for this is the Betty and Barney Hill abduction case. It was one of the very first reported UFO abductions, at least in America. And they actually reported that there was a star map that they had seen on board the ship, and they drew it out. And it wasn't until several years later when the equipment on the Hubble Space Telescope was looking in that area, they were able to identify those actual stars. And so everyone was like, wow, how did these people actually be able to have this knowledge unless there was something statistically significant about it? How would they know this knowledge before science actually discovered it? And I think a really, really big part of this too is when there's a man by the name of Bob Lazar who actually claimed that he worked at Area 51 and did some studies there. And they had an element called Element 115 that was essentially the UFO particle. You would bombard protons on it, and when it split apart, it would cause anti-gravity effects. And he predicted this in 1983, and currently today this element is actually just recently discovered and scientifically verified in the IUPAC table, and element 115 is now officially known as Moscovium, and it is exactly the way he described it in 1983, and so there's that too. And then this is just the last slide for the night. I guess it's a bit shorter, but remember to have fun. It's all about having fun here. And I showed Shelby one of these videos earlier. This is a different one, by the way. This is a man, his legal name is Phil Hill. Phil Hill. And he's a comedian and a musician, and he understands that there's also the comical aspect and comical side to this. And it's like why I put the tinfoil hats on the Rush Week table, is to show this. It's about having fun too, and acknowledging the quirky sides to this this area. And so he understands it really, really well, and he can really play that out well in this character. So I'll show you this video, and then that will be it for the night. That guy is insane. And then Thank you for coming out to the lecture. And next week is the Earth Files, and in honor of the new X-Files season, which I'm not going to watch for some time because I'm still on season 5, I'm doing the Earth Files, which essentially is the real-life version of the X-Files, and there's a person that actually deals with things like that in the crop circles and cow mutilation. So it's a really interesting topic. And thank you.